And welcome to Tim TV, also known as Happy Hour with Maestro Tim. Today we have an amazing guest artist. He just recently played at the US Open with the great Harry Connick Jr. He's collaborated with some of my idols like the Grateful Dead, Sting, and Kurt Elling. He was the Tonight Show band leader from the early to mid 90s. My God, he's played with most of the great orchestras in this country and abroad, and we were so lucky to have him a couple years back as one of our guest artists. It's my honor to welcome the great Branford Marsalis. Branford, thank you so much for saying yes and being here. Yay! So, let's have some fun.
Yep.
First of all, where are you and what are you drinking?
I'm in Durham, North Carolina, and I'm drinking Blanton.
Excellent. I'm not allowed to endorse anything, but for those who are in our immediate viewing area, I'm supporting local, and you know what it is. And you know what? A lot of people don't realize that, but if you look really, really, really closely at Iowa, you might find a little bit of corn. So,
a little bit.
Yeah, just a little bit. So here's an idea. Let's drink it.
Yes.
So cheers to you, sir.
Cheers, my man.
Hey, I wanted to start, first of all, on a little bit of a serious tone, and then we'll lighten it up a bit.
Sure.
I look back to that concert that we did, my goodness, that was in 2017, as one of the highlights of my career, musically, but for other reasons, because there's so many times when we play, you don't know who's in the audience, and you don't know who you're moving and what and the difference you're making in somebody's life. And that weekend, that person happened to be me. My dad was dying, and didn't have much long to live. And my heart wasn't really into it for obvious reasons. And I didn't even think I was even going to conduct that concert. And so then all of a sudden you show up and you just absolutely just blew the doors out of everybody. And it wasn't just musically, but your personality. And I was just smiling and grinning like a fool for the next 2 weeks. So I'm really glad we got a chance to see each other face to face, because I wanted to thank you for making a difference in my life when I really, really needed it.
I appreciate that. I mean, that's what music does for us, though.
It sure does. I also know fairly shortly after that, your mom passed away, and now recently your dad has. So let's start there. Let's start with your parents about how they raised you and molded you into the person and musician that you are today.
My dad's the ice and my mom's the fire.
Great.
I know it's one of those weird things when Wynton and I started to succeed, we do these interviews and they would always say, your dad was really a great influence. It's like, yeah, well, my mom. And they said, no, your dad. It was like still that time. We weren't ready.
Yeah.
They have discussions about moms. And my mom was she was a beast. I mean, she was to be feared first and loved second. My dad, everybody loved my dad. Like, everybody calls my dad Ellis. Everybody calls my mom Miss Marsalis.
Oh, interesting. Yeah.
You had to see it. I mean, I have so many great stories, but
one of my time.
One of my favorite stories is I had this band that we may revive. I hope during COVID we revive it. It's a band called Buckshot LaFunk. It was like this strange kind of R&B slash rock and roll slash hip hop band with all these young kids. They were a lot younger than me, most of them. And we were touring in the mid 90s. And my mother decides to come to New Jersey to hear the band live because she liked the record. And we had this weird thing with this band. The band was really great. And whenever we would take a break, we'd take a 2-week break and then we'd start. And anytime we started a new leg, the first gig was just atrocious. And I have no explanation for it. And it happened for 2 years. So after a while, I'm like, well, okay, my mom's coming to the sucky gig. No problem. So we played in Jersey. We sucked. And the band, nobody knows my mom. And he said, oh, Ms. Marcellus, how'd you like the concert? Now, every mom in Iowa would say, oh, it was really great. You guys are great. It's so great to see you. I'm so proud of my son. My mother says, so did y'all rehearse before y'all did this concert? I said, well, no, ma'am, because, and they were trying to explain, he said, well, that's what I thought, because that's exactly what it sounded like. A bunch of guys on stage with no discipline and no rehearsal, stealing money. Y'all got paid for this, right? You got paid to sound that terrible. How does that make you feel? Wow. And then the guys in the band were like, damn, man, is she like that all the time? I'm like, man, she's being easy on y'all. Yeah, like all the time. And they were like, so when she came to another gig, they're like, oh, no, your mom's coming. My dad comes. I'm like, oh, yeah, your dad's coming. My mom's like, oh, no. But she came to this gig, and we were on. And she was like, yeah, that's a lot better than the last time I heard y'all. It's like that was her thing. She's the fire. So and my dad was always the ice. He was always the way he thought about the world was just a little different than, you know, than the way dad, you know. So I was playing clarinet at the time, and I won all city. And not a lot of really great clarinet players in New Orleans in 1976. I didn't practice a lot. And I'm like, yeah, dad, I made all city. And he goes, well, son, you know, in the land of the blind, the one-eyed man is always king.
Oh!
So I went, wow, I can't even get like an attaboy out of my own father. He said, son, one of the things I've learned in life is that there are very few people who get any better by kissing their own ass. Mm-hmm. And I tried to come up with a comeback and it was like,
good. Oh, yeah.
Got it.
So
and it stuck. It stuck. I mean, when you, if you see interviews, I mean, with Wynton or with me or any of my brothers, we generally don't talk about ourselves. Because my dad and my mom, they weren't having it.
Right.
It just, when you don't use whatever success you have as a referendum on you.
Right.
Because this is the byproduct of a lot of things and a lot of people who invested time in you and did things for you. So you should be more grateful than boastful.
Right. Okay, so you said she thought you sucked on some of those gigs. How important, as an artist and a soloist, to suck in public?
It's the most important thing you can do. I know the instinct, the fear-based instinct, is to say, well, I'm going to practice this piece and I'm never going to play it until it's ready. So if you're going to do that, and I actually had one of my agents actually recommend that. Just find one or two pieces that you can play and then really drill down on them, and then you just play them for the rest of your life. I'm like, what the hell? Why would I want to do that?
Right,
you know?
Yeah.
What's the point of that? So I know musicians who don't play songs they don't know, don't play things they're not familiar with. But the only way to train your brain to get used to that is to do it. And when I walked on stage, the first classical performance I had was with the Orpheus Chamber Orchestra. And I was in the elevator at Carnegie Hall. And
I've heard of it. Yeah.
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 Yeah. Quaint little building.
Yeah.
A lot of potential there. A lot of potential one day. And I was in the elevator and I was going down to the stage and I kept saying, all right, man, you know, you got this. Now, first of all, I have never said that to myself in my life. So as soon as I said, you got this, I went, wow, you are so screwed. And I was. Because I never said that. I never had to give myself a pep talk. So, you know, I got it. I got through it. It was terrible. And I played a bunch of gigs with them. And I was excited because I was learning. And one of the flutists saw me trading bawdy jokes with one of the percussionists before the concert. And she said, how do you do that? I said, do what? She says, well, right before I'm a player soloist, I get so, you know, I have to like throw up in a bucket somewhere. I'm so anxious. And I said, well, if I thought that would make me better, I would be at the bucket right now. What I understand is that, I mean, this is as good as I can play right now.
Right.
And the only way that I can see myself improving is doing this. So I am accepting the fact that it is sad, and I'm just going to go out there and play to the best of my ability, which is sad, but it will improve if I just stick to it and keep getting, you know, hitting the head with this baseball bat. And I thought it would take 2 years. It took about seven. But then in the eighth year, I would play concerts and say, wow, that doesn't suck anymore. Notice I didn't say it was good. But it's like, wow, it doesn't suck.
That's your mom talking.
maybe, but I just still didn't think it was good. But
right.
It wasn't like, it's like this thing when people expect you to sound like crap and you don't sound totally like crap. Then in their minds, they talk to you like it's the greatest performance they ever heard because it exceeds the expectation.
Right.
So the first 5 years were like, hey, thanks for playing. And after that, I was like, wow, man, you sound great. And I'm like, well, no, not really. You just expected the other guy.
Right. Yeah.
You know, and I just hung in there. And the saxophone community was really gracious to me. I mean, they were very like, they kind of said, man, just hang in there. Just keep working at it. And they gave me tips. This guy, Arnold Bornkamp, out of the Netherlands, and Tim McAllister teaches at Michigan now, and you know, all, you know, all, like a lot of saxophone players, you know, at these conferences, James Humble and I'm forgetting the names because I'm on the spot, but it was just a group. They were very, very, they were suspicious at first because they're like, why is he showing up doing this stuff? And then when they heard me talking about it, and I said, man, I'm in it for the long haul. They were great, and they really helped me out, and made me a lot better, and I'm very grateful to them.
You know, on this same vein, one of my best friends, who's also happens to be a board member, he is a huge fan of yours and also of Kurt Elling's. I mean, so much so that if he could, he would throw his plus-sized underwear through the camera at you right now. Yeah, you know who I'm talking about. Anyway, but he forwarded me an article from the New York Times about how all these clubs in New York are closing because of the pandemic, like the Blue Note and the Village Vanguard and all of those. And right. I'm assuming it's happened the same in New Orleans. Tell us a little bit more about the importance of live performing and succeeding and or failing in front of a live and yet discerning audience.
It's the only way to succeed is to fail in front of a live and discerning audience.
Do you teach that to your students? Because I
tell that to my students. I think some of them don't believe it because there's such a pervasive fear of failure in our culture right now.
Right.
There is such a pervasive inability to apologize for mistakes and apologize for transgressions. The appearance of perfection.
Right.
I mean, you know, in the TikTok age or the, you know, Instagram age, the appearance of perfection is way more important than the quest for it.
Mm.
And it's hard to convince these kids. I mean, I have one student, what I always do with my students is I make them learn solos by great musicians by ear.
Sure.
And one of my particular students was incredibly livid about this because he was so incredibly bad at it. So there's a book, I'm tying all these things together, by a psychologist named Carol Dweck. She wrote a book called Mindset. And while there are clearly more categories of human beings than she allowed for, she basically lumped us all into two mindsets: the fixed mindset and the growth mindset. And she said that the person with the fixed mindset believes that God only gives out intelligence to a handful of people, and of course, they're one of them. So anytime that there are situations or data that will force the fixed mindset to confront the fact that they're not as good as they thought they were, they immediately start to diminish the data. We kind of live in that right now. But the growth mindset is like, wow, I feel that. Give me more. I want to get better. It's an oversimplification at the end of the day, but it was really a fascinating book about, and she said she found these characteristics in kids as early as 3 or 4 years old, where a 4-year-old was really good at something, and then they gave him something he wasn't good at, and he says, I don't like that. Let's go back to the thing I'm good at. So this particular student was a fixed mindset person. And I was talking to the students about using their ears, learning, because the music system is one of the simplest systems in the world. It seems complex, but it's only 12 notes. And at any time, you have a 1 in 12 chance of being right. It's a really great odds.
That's not bad. Yeah.
Really great odds. But the thing that's infinite in the world is sound. Sound is infinite. You have all these cultures, you have all these things. I mean, I have, like Wolfgang Mozart and Jimi Hendrix use the exact same system.
Right.
Couldn't sound more different.
Right.
Notes are the same,
Yep.
but how those notes sound are dramatically different. And he kind of chimes in really angrily. Well, maybe that's good for you, but some people aren't meant for this. And I'll tame it down. I said, how the blank do you know?
Right.
You just started on this. And he beautifully naively says, I've been doing this shit for 6 weeks. Only a young person.
Well, case closed
Only a
then.
young person.
Well,
6 weeks. So I turned him and I said, so how long does it take a baby to learn how to walk? He's like, how do I know? I said, that's a fair enough question. I'll just throw you the thing. All right. Takes a baby anywhere from 8 months to 15 months, depending on the baby. Some babies walk early, some babies walk late. And they have this whole process. And one day you're going to have kids and you see it. They're crawling and they're crawling. And some are frustrated because they see us walking and they want to walk. So they stand up and then they smile, then they fall, then they cry because they want to walk and they can't. The brain's not right. The code's not written yet. It's not time. And it's just a whole process that goes on for weeks and months and months. And then finally they stand up and they walk 2 times and they fall. And then eventually they get it. Well, using your mindset for a baby, they will walk twice, fall down, and say, I quit, carry
Done.
me,
Yeah.
I'm done, this isn't for me. And he goes, oh, okay, well, fair enough. I said, nah, man, you're gonna hear what I'm saying. And I really bore down on him. I went Dolores Marcellus on him.
So I, th that actually that actually that actually brings me to this question. So are you a hard ass as a teacher then?
Depends on the student.
Yeah.
I mean, some students can't take that.
Right.
I mean, I prefer to be a hard ass. I mean, I've learned more from hard asses than I am from people who, oh, very interesting. Maybe you want to try this. They don't really
Right.
work for me.
Right.
But that particular student, he gave me a call literally 2 years later and said, I can do it now, man. This is the greatest thing ever. Thanks.
Right.
But it took him 2 years.
Right.
And that's the point.
Right.
But yeah, I'm definitely more of a direct kind of hard ass. I mean, that's, when you're playing like high school football and you're one of the worst people on the team, you always get yelled at.
Yeah.
And there was no society at that time that said, hey, coach, you can't yell at that guy. Everybody yelled at me.
Right.
I was like, okay, I'm going to go out here and I'm fodder for the better players and I'm going to get yelled at. What's the big deal?
Right.
And kids, I don't really yell. I mean, but my mother wasn't a yeller. She just had this way of talking where she could use words like a scimitar and just pound her chest
Yeah.
with words,
Yeah.
and I definitely inherited that from her.
Right. So one thing that we pride ourselves at Orchestra Iowa, we have this room that, well, that was our VIP room when you were here. It's called Opus, and that's where we have First Friday Jazz that's supported by KCCK. We
Right.
have a lot of live
I
music
remember that.
going
That
on
was
there.
fun.
It's
I
a
enjoyed.
great place, but it's the only place in the area where jazz musicians, actually any musician, can actually come in, ply their craft, get paid for it. Are you worried about not having venues for the next generation to actually go out there and play, to create the craft and make maybe make a living?
I'm worried about the next generation not being very good. I'm not
Wow.
really worried about the venues. The venues will show up. New Orleans isn't really a problem in terms of venues. The reason that the problems, reason that the clubs are closing in New York, the Village Vanguard is an exception, actually, not because Max owns the building.
Yeah.
But when you're renting, and your rent is $35,000 a month, and your income is zero, it's tough.
The math doesn't work so well, does it? Yeah.
Work well. And the thing about New Orleans is New Orleans is one of those places, and I was one of those places where you can actually own the place where your club is,
Right.
which is a completely, New York, the land has been purchased for 100 years. And if you don't have maximum amounts of money, hundreds of millions of dollars, you ain't buying it.
Right.
But I mean, that's why New York is having the problem that it's having, is that the rents have been exorbitant and rising and rising and rising and rising and rising. And much like most of those kind of businesses, much like restaurants, much like airlines, they have enough cash for the month in front of them. That's it. That's the cash they have. They don't have a cash surplus of 6, 7, 8, 9 months like some of these other corporations do.
Right.
With the exception of one airline that locked in, what was it, Southwest? Yeah, Southwest. They locked in a gasoline deal with a company, and they basically bought like 20 years worth of gas at a price, and then the prices shot up, and they're
Sure.
cool. But most airlines didn't do that, mostly because they didn't have the cash to do it.
Right.
They're publicly traded companies. It's complicated. And the jazz club's no different. Month to month, everything is month to month. And then suddenly you have zero income for 6 months. How do you stay open?
Right. Yeah.
So I'm not really worried about the venues, because if the musicians can play, then the venues will show up.
Right.
I'm worried more about the musicians really not liking jazz enough to do the thing that's necessary to play jazz well.
Right. You know, I find that perspective really refreshing because here in Iowa, we've kind of bought into the mantra, build it and they will come. Which is true if you're
Yes,
talking about people, but not necessarily buildings.
right.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, the great thing about that book and the great thing about the movie, and when I saw the movie, I was 25, I think.
God, are we that old?
Yeah, we are.
Shit.
Yeah. And it is that old.
Yeah.
Imagine how old Kevin Costner's Dusty was. So, I saw it, and I went at noon, 1 o'clock in the afternoon, because they were cheaper prices. And I was surrounded by all of these men in business suits. And when the lights came on, they were all crying. And I turned around and go, what the hell's wrong with these people? It's a baseball movie.
Right.
Of course, I grew up.
Right.
Then I realized it's not really a baseball movie.
Right.
It's a baseball movie. It's a metaphor. It's a metaphor for sons and their fathers.
Right.
And I was very fortunate to not have that kind of problematic relationship with my father.
Right.
So I would not have cried when the movie came up, even now, but I would understand better if I saw people who were.
Let me go a little farther in that because there's, I think the most proud moment of any parent is to see their child spread their wings and fly. Are you conscious of that moment when you thought to yourself, "Hey, you know, I think I can do this. I think I might have a future doing this."
No, my parents were just like, you have to go. it was just different, you know. It was just different. Like, you can't stay here.
Right.
There were six of us, and I was at the top. And it's like, there's five underneath you. You got to go. Figure
right.
it out.
Right.
And you know, I was an R&B guy. I mean, I played in the orchestra, but I was an R&B guy.
Sure.
And when I decided I wanted to play jazz, I never really thought that I would actually make that happen.
Okay. Yeah.
But I was all about the adventure. You know, because Wynton was the one saying, man, you can make it here. You need to be here. I'm like, New York? Nah, man, that's just too much energy for me. I'm just a country boy. And I said, well, you know what? I'll go and I have enough money saved because I worked. I had jobs. And I said, I have enough money saved for 6 months. So I'll go there. And then when the money runs out, I'll come home and I can tell my kids a great story about the time I lived in New York for 6 months. And right around the fourth month, people started calling me for gigs. And I'm like, man, are people that sad here that they're calling me? And I'm not joking. I'm like, are they that sad that they're calling me? And it worked out. It worked out. But when the older guys told me, you have a lot of potential, but you have a lot of work to do, I didn't dismiss them. I didn't say, oh, you're just old. We're the new sound and you guys got to get out of the way. I said, well, okay, what you got? And they gave me a laundry list. And it took 2 decades to sort out all of this information that they dumped on me. And they were right, and I'm eternally grateful.
Well, hey, first of all, let's toast again to fooling most of the people most of the time then. And nice,
that, bro. And, really?
And nice touch on the round ice. I've got a couple in my freezer as well.
Hey, man. Slow dispersal is the way.
I totally get the physics. Yeah.
Slow dispersal. Life is patience.
So my next door neighbor asked me to ask you this. So let me back up. So I spent a couple years in Oregon. Mm. And anybody who lives in Oregon gets really pissed when they call it Oregon.
Right.
And people in San Francisco can't stand it when you call the city Frisco.
Right.
How do you pronounce New Orleans without getting slapped?
Just like that.
Okay. Okay. What shouldn't you say?
You definitely should not say Nawlins.
Okay, good, good.
That's that crap that dopey actor came up with in that movie, The Big Easy.
Right, yeah.
Because he couldn't say New Orleans, which is what they say. Welcome right. to New Orleans. So he shortened it to Nawlins. I can't remember his name. He's the Texas guy. Quaid. Dennis Quaid.
Oh, him, yeah.
He smiled and he said, hey, y'all. Welcome to Nawlins. And I went, where the hell is that? You can't say that. And the other one that people say is New Orleans, which that's not it.
Yeah, that just makes you.
Even though Jelly Roll Morton used to call it New Orleans.
Oh, really?
But it wasn't. Yeah, you hear him talking. When I was down in New Orleans.
Oh, you know, funny.
It's still wrong.
Right. Okay, so one of the ties that bind is the love of alcohol and food. So if I were to go to New Orleans and.
In that order, yes.
Right. Where's your favorite place to eat that I might actually find you chowing down in? I got my pen here. Here we go.
Oh, crap. Okay. There's a couple of places. I gotta remember the names of them because I just go to them. One for sure is August.
August. Okay. Wait a sec. I'm writing this down. I'm taking notes here. Okay. Master, teach the student. What else?
August, my girl, what's her name? Susan Spicer's place, Bayona.
Bayona.
B-A-Y-O-N-A.
My next door neighbor would say, yeah, I dated her in college. Bayona, got it, yes.
Wow. The Mobar, M-E-A-U-X-B-A-R.
M-A-E... UX, the Mobar. Got it.
Mobar is great.
I hope everyone else is taking notes because, you know, what I love about New Orleans is that they do not tolerate crappy food.
We really, well, depends. Some of the places where the tourists frequent, yeah.
There you go. Yeah, yeah.
Like everybody can't wait to go to Mother's.
Yeah, you're right. I fell into that trap, I'll admit. Yeah, got it. Yeah.
I got a phone call from the guys in the Dave Matthews Band. They did a record there. They did a couple of records there. And Jeff Coffin, the saxophone player, says, "Man, we're just thinking about you. We're standing in the line at Mother's." I said, "Run!" I said, "Get the hell out of there." "Where should we go?" I said, I'll send you like contacts. So what are you looking for? What are you trying to eat?" I said, "Check with me every day and I'll find you a spot. Get out of that line."
Good for you. So actually, we're coming up to the half hour, so I know there are a lot of people who are listening in right now, so I'm going to check our chat room.
We can hang a little, man. It's fine.
Are you
Drink.
sure? Because I would love to reach out to our listening audience and have them ask you a few questions, because I got a feeling that their questions are going to be a lot more important. So let me just go online here and see what's going on here. Oh my God. Wow. Branford, I hope you have a full bottle.
I got another bottle. It's fine. I got a whole, yeah, I got a lot of stuff up there.
Yes. Oh my God. Some people are giving their own recommendations for breakfast. Jen Wasco. Yep. Okay. She was asking, yeah. Jen Wasco was asking, best breakfast in New Orleans.
There's a lot of spots.
We're talking hangover, best breakfast.
There's a lot of spots.
Okay, severe hangover,
Oh, well, I
best
can't help
breakfast.
it. Best breakfast is Elizabeth's is great. There's a brunch at a, let me see if I can, what street is that on? Is it on Louisiana? There's a brunch spot that's really great. It has an atchafalaya. That's the name of it. Atchafalaya.
Could you say that slowly again? Atchafalai? Oh, did
Atchafalaya.
I? Atchafalai.
Atchafalaya.
Wow.
On Louisiana Avenue. Atchafalaya is great.
Wow.
Breakfast spots. There's
Perfect.
another breakfast spot. I mean, it's just a good
I'm talking heart stopping, just vein clogging, really goodness.
got to go to Galatoire's.
Galatoire's. Gee, man, you are just a wealth of information. This is
Galatoire.
why I brought you on here. It's a music, yeah, but no, it's about the food and the booze. Galatoire.
Galatoire apostrophe S.
Excellent. So,
Galatoire.
Kathy Varney wants to know what you're working on right now.
My golf game.
Excellent. And who's winning?
What I'm working on, I was, I'm finishing up a score for a Netflix movie that's coming out soon called Ma Rainey's Black Bottom. Starring Chadwick Boseman and Viola Davis. They're the two big names. And in addition to that, I'm playing the Glazunov Concerto and the Hector Villa-Lobos Fantasia with the Philadelphia Orchestra first week of October. I'm writing a piece for a baritone saxophonist, Arno Bornkamp, and I'm working on a piece based on Hungarian folk tunes that's due sometime in November.
So tell us about discipline. There's a lot of musicians who aren't playing, who aren't working. It's hard if you don't have a goal in mind. So how do you inspire others or yourself? I mean, to prepare, to practice, to learn new things, in your case, even compose. Obviously, people need a purpose, but how is that discipline thing going?
Well, for me, I mean, I took a month off. It
Yeah.
was great. And then I started again, and I was like, wow, this sucks. I mean, it took me 3 days to get my soprano chops back. But I just think that if I have The only thing that I think that the only thing that I think I'm when I think I'm really blessed with is that my relationship with music is no different than my relationship with my friends and relationships. I don't have transactional relationships. I don't have relationships that are contingent upon, you having a particular stature or doing a certain thing, or I just don't have that in my life. So I was never the guy where somebody would say, "Hey man, you want to do this gig?" And I'd say, "Well, what's the bread? How much am I getting paid?"
Right.
My question was, "Well, what's the gig?"
Right.
And if it's not musically thrilling, I'm like, "Eh, no, I'm good. Pays well, it's okay."
Right.
And that worked out well for me.
Right.
I started, like last yesterday, I was leaving New York because, after they opened, I was driving, and it's an 8-hour drive, and 4 of those hours were spent listening and re-listening to Ivan the Terrible by Prokofiev. Why? Because it's killing. Because it deserves to be heard. There's no outcome for that. When I started writing the music for this movie, it takes place in 1929. I've been listening to 20s music for the last 10 years or more.
Right.
Not for a reason other than how can it hurt to know more?
Right.
So when it showed up, I'm like, "Oh, great. I get to put this 20 stuff to use that I've been listening to." It was like that was the whole idea. It was, but there was it was it wasn't a transaction. Well, I'm going to listen to this because I might get a gig. And when the director of the film was insistent that we find a singer that can sing like Ma Rainey, I know you can't.
Oh, yeah. Good
You
luck.
can't,
Yeah.
because you can't find a singer with any talent that's going to spend months trying to learn how to sing like someone that they can't monetize.
Okay. Now you've opened up a path here. You've recently, well, in the last 4 years or so, been working with Kurt Elling.
Yeah.
Tell us about your chemistry between the two, because and what makes him great, and what makes you great in that partnership.
What makes Kurt great for me is his intonation is great. The tone of his voice is incredible. And he is able to do something that most jazz singers can't do, but operatic singers can do, is that he can change the color of the sound of his voice to match whatever the emotional content of the song is. And that's unique in jazz. I have a friend of mine named, I don't remember Stefan's last name, but his name is Stefan, and he is an agent
Right.
for operatic singers in Germany. And his good friend is also named Stefan, and they go to operas together with regularity. And we went to an incredibly strange version of Salome,
Oh, wow, yeah.
where John the Baptist was a Gitmo prisoner in an orange jumpsuit. And I'm sitting there going, "Okay,
Boy.
that's kind of out, but okay, sure.
Okay, yeah.
Okay, that's weird, but okay, sure." And so the whole thing was just, but when he came, when he heard the concert, they were so excited.
Right.
This Kurt Elling, so many colors in his voice. Jazz singers do not have this. I said, I
Yeah.
know they don't.
Hold
And that
on.
was the thing. I knew that if we did a happy song, it could sound happy. If we did a sad song, it would sound sad. And it wasn't one of these things where he had a particular style that he had to impose on every setting.
I'm going to check our chat room again, and I'm going to come back to you about color, because I think that's the most sophist one of the most sophisticated things you can impart on a musician. Let's see here, what anything we've talked about breakfast. Yep, and Lawrence, great to see you. Oh, best French cuisine from Michelle Bennett. Okay, we are still back in the food here. So best French cuisine, and let's talk about color of sound.
Best French cuisine in New Orleans. Oh yeah, okay. There's a place we go for French cuisine. It's in Uptown. I got to get the name of it. The chef is Moroccan.
Wow.
But Morocco was a French colony.
Sure it was, yep. Yep.
Because, let me look it up. That's the thing about growing up there. You just know where these places
you
are.
Just you just go, yeah.
Oh, well, one of the great ones. It's not really French cuisine, but Café des Gars is incredible.
Ooh, Café des Gars.
Like the painter.
Ah, des Gars. Wonderful. You know, I could like eat my body weight in like oysters and heavy cream. Yeah, it's and call it a day.
Yes. another good restaurant that is kind of French is Evangeline on Decatur Street.
Evangeline, man, I hope everyone's See, taking notes. Man.
Is it if you go to Galatoire's?
Yeah.
And you go to Arnaud's, ARNAUD'S. I mean. It's clearly French influence. It is not straight.
If only you could. If only you knew that from the name of the restaurant. Really. I
yeah. Exactly. That's what I mean. It is so. You know, what's the name of this restaurant? I right. can't find it. It's showing all. Let me think. Okay. Let me. What's the name of that street? It's really good too. The chef's name is Monsef.
I love it. The fact that you even know the chefs. God bless you. I mean, they're artists. They're artists, man. So let me.
Wait a minute. I do it this way. I put my our zip code in, and then it'll come up. French cuisine 70118.
So I'm thinking a lot about New Orleans right now, and also Biloxi and Mobile. I mean, they're getting just hammered right now.
We're used to it. It's only a category two. New Orleans is not getting hammered, actually.
Oh, really?
It's getting rained on.
Well, that's just it. I mean, there's like 3 feet of rain that's just dumping on them.
Yeah, you know, that's our
that's,
thing.
Yeah.
You know, how many people I heard from in New Orleans today?
Hmm.
None.
Oh.
That's our thing.
Because maybe they're hunkered down. I don't know.
I'm still working. When the Katrina was happening, everybody's like, bro, this is the big one. We getting the hell out of here.
Right.
Nobody getting out of there because of that. It's like, yeah, you know. So, yeah, it'll rain. It'll flood. Floods will go down. It'll be fine. I can't find the name of the restaurant that it's really good, though. I wish I, you know. I'll text my brother.
Perfect.
And then before we're done.
Which brother? You have more than one.
Delphia.
Ah, excellent. He still lives there?
Oh, yes.
Excellent.
And Jason.
So let me end with a question that I don't want you to hold back on. That's a serious question. It's a timely question.
That's a hard thing for me because I'm really reserved.
Yeah, you know? That's true. I just thought it took me about, what, 40 minutes to get you out of your shell?
Yeah, you know, and the bourbon helps.
Sure. So we're at a really interesting time in history. And I was wondering, are you more optimistic, less optimistic, or what are your feelings about today about equal justice and equal protection under the law?
I mean, I don't really give a damn about optimism. I'm pretty sure that Dred Scott was optimistic in 1857. When you think about the history of, I mean, I'm narrowing it down, because when you think about the history of women in America, women in the world, women who were willing to sacrifice their careers and their lives for the rights of other women, and blacks who were sacrificing their lives and fighting for civil rights, is that the name of the restaurant is Jamila's.
That's funny. You are in touch with your brothers. So, for the record, you're on good terms with your brothers.
Evidently not.
Jamila.
AMILA'S.
Say that again. I interrupted you.
Jamila, apostrophe S, Jamila's.
Awesome.
So anyway, what the society would generally say is, you know, we sympathize with you, but now is not the time.
Yeah.
Teddy Roosevelt invited Booker T. Washington to the White House, and the vitriol was so great. As a matter of fact, one of the senators from a particular state, and if I could remember the state, I would have, I think it was South Carolina, but I see you don't want to be wrong when you say stuff like this.
Sure, yeah.
But basically his response was like, you know, now we have to hang 100 more to keep them in their place. So it was clear that what Teddy Roosevelt understood was that, yes, he might not think like this, and he's trying to further the agenda of equality, but now is not the right time. So during the rest of his presidency, he never touched that electric wire again. I have a bunch of friends here in North Carolina who are Republicans, and the thing that they're struggling with is that the acceptance that now is the time. And that's the thing. And what I told them is that, you know, Martin Luther King thought that the time was 1968, but it wasn't. And he paid for it with his life. And there were lots of women who fought for suffrages, for suffrage. There were lots of, there was a woman who in England who lost her family and was committed to an insane asylum because she wanted the right to vote, because the society was not ready for these sorts of things. I just posted an article on my social media accounts today about Shinzo Abe promising women that this was their time in Japan and how none of it has come to fruition.
Right.
Because the time is not right. But then when the time is right, it's just right. So it doesn't really matter about optimism, is that all of these things are related, because most people are not racist. Most people have lives. They're trying to feed their families. They're doing all these things. They don't have time to think about this. George Floyd happened in a pandemic where people had nothing else to do but watch their TVs and watch YouTube and see this over and over and over again. And this was the turning point. Because if it had been, what's the difference between George Floyd and Tamir Rice? Nothing really, except people were home and they right. were watching, and they said, this cannot be happening. And suddenly there's the realization that not only has it happened, but it's been happening. And as Dave Chappelle said, I'm too old to be out there. I'm backseat driving, but you guys are excellent drivers. When I turned on the television and saw that the protesters were equal amounts black and white, I'm like, yeah, the time is now.
Right.
The time is here. And for the people who prefer the status quo and it's upsetting to them, now they know how Martin Luther King felt, or how Dred Scott felt, or how a number of other people, or, you know, people, Ralph Abernathy felt, or, you know, Reverend Shuttlesworth felt. I mean, there's all these people who tried to, or Elizabeth Cady Stanton felt, or, you know, it's just like, you can, you know, I could go on and on and on, or how Sacagawea felt, or how numerous Indian activists felt, or how the Indians felt, and the slaves of the Indians on the Trail of Tears. I mean, this history of all of this kind of, you know, thing. And we're at this time where, you know, if someone would, like, someone says, you know, I'm not into this, and they say, what's your response? I don't really need to have a response to this, because the time is clearly now, because of what is happening. I mean, I was doing a recording session in Lafayette, Louisiana. And I was driving down Interstate 10 back to New Orleans. And it's like 2 hours. And I got to Baton Rouge, and it was a sign. And it said something like, we hear you and we see you. And now is the time for action. Black Lives Matter. And in the right corner, it was Dow Chemical. And I went, Jesus, Dow Chemical? It is definitely the right time. Dow Chemical.
Dow Chemical.
Not like, you know, Southern Poverty Law Center. Dow Chemical. And I went, wow, now I've seen everything. And right. Okay, we're at that time. So it doesn't really matter about how optimistic or pessimistic I feel, because the world doesn't care. These things happen when they happen. You know what I mean? And it's great. And I'm watching it and I'm going, wow, I didn't think I would see it in my lifetime. It's happening. That's great.
See, this is why I asked you to come on. You were just awesome.
Just for the bourbon, you know it.
Oh, I know. And we only get smarter the more we drink, you know. Everybody knows that. Man. Yeah.
Everybody.
Listen, a lot of my musicians are hurting. They're out of work.
Yes, we are.
There's a lot of uncertainty out there. And I know a lot of my musicians are tuning in right now watching this.
It's not uncertainty, there's certainty.
Yeah. Could you say some words of encouragement to them?
We're coming back.
Yeah.
Okay, this is what you can do. Go to Google or go to a search engine if you're not into Google, because some people, you know, and search Louis Armstrong 1918 pandemic.
Yay.
And Louis Armstrong talks about the 1918 pandemic, because I like it when people say, oh, you know, people are going to be like, you know, they're not going to go out and they're not going to. I said, all right. There was a 1918 pandemic and people were dying in droves and people were indoors and concerts stopped and everything stopped all over the world. World War I ended 1918 and the Volstead Act was passed in 1919, prohibition. And the entire country was drunk as hell by 1920.
Yeah, yeah.
So, it's easy to sit here and say, oh, people are not. We got people fighting to die right now. We got people to fighting to go into indoor places without masks and get sick. So, okay, great. You can think of them as pioneers or you can think of them as fools or whatever it is. I personally will not do it. The reason I know there's not going to be concerts anytime soon, because I would not pay to go to a concert right now.
Yeah.
But I think that in 2021, we're going to come to a resolution. Particularly if people in the country decide to vote for a president that would have a national plan, as opposed to this, you know, we can't kill this thing if we have 50 plans.
Right.
50 plans and false optimism. It's just not a good strategy, you know, and this has nothing to do with me. It has nothing to do with politics, even though most people will take all of these statements in a political lens. I don't really care. That ain't really it. You know, it's like, we need a national plan. I think yesterday or the day before, Canada reported zero deaths.
That's my country. That is my country.
What's the difference? National plan.
And better beer. Sorry, it's true.
I'm not even going to argue about that.
Yeah, don't bother.
I wouldn't, you know, because, I mean, I wouldn't jump up and down for Labatt's, my friend.
Well, yeah, true.
And that's just one of the many.
And you would for Bud? Come on, clearly? What? Really?
So you go to the bottom.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I'm throwing it down, baby.
For a Beta.
We've got the same hairstyle. Yeah, that's right.
No, mine is better than yours, because I've embraced it. It's gone. It's over. Abita Springs, that's a good beer. And all those great microbreweries in the United States that you never heard of.
That's right.
Come on. You got killer beer here.
Amen. Yep.
Labatt's Blue, not great.
Yeah, it's true that.
Not great, my friend. But yeah, you know, it's like they got zero deaths. Zero.
Yeah.
What can you say to that? I mean, it's a national plan. New York, the mortality rate is less than 1%.
Right. Yeah.
But everybody bought in.
Right.
And because of a million reasons, you know, we have people who are like not buying in. And I mean, I can't even fathom that a mask would be politicized. I don't even understand it.
Right.
I don't understand what that is. But I can't control that. All I can say is that, you know, I was in the hospital with my dad when he died of COVID. My brother Delphio had COVID.
I didn't know that was the specifics. I'm so sorry.
Yeah. Oh, it's life, man.
Yeah.
But I talked to the doctors and the nurses, and they told me what I had to do, and I did everything that I had to do. And when I was walking in grocery stores with gloves on and masks, and people in New Orleans were like, "Man, you all right, man?" I'm like, "I'm fine, but you're about to be not all right."
Right.
Well, we'll see about that. And 2 weeks later, the whole city was just full of it, because you just got to take it seriously.
Right.
You just have to, you know, it's, and I think it's hard to take it seriously. Sure. Oh, okay. No. It's dinner time.
What's for dinner?
Well, gluten-free pasta for me.
What? I'll be right over.
Yeah. Yeah, you just have to take it seriously. And I think it's hard to take it seriously because it's invisible.
Right.
Like, you know, if everyone turned into zombies, everyone will obey.
Right. Yeah.
But it's invisible. And you're walking around and you're saying, "I feel fine. This thing is ridiculous. What are you, you know?" It's like there's so many in your mind. You go, "This is surreal that this is actually happening." And in the biggest reality is that the majority of the people that we know don't know anyone who's actually been affected by this.
Right. It's hard to fight that which you can't see. You're right.
Yeah.
You're right.
So it kind of resolves itself. And my thing is that, you know, like, I'm a Southern liberal. I'm not a Northern liberal. Northern liberals kind of believe it's their moral imperative to, like, cure the world of whatever they think the world's disease is.
Right.
Which I always laughed at, because when I'm from the South. You just got to, you know, you are always in the minority. You just got to deal with people. And then in the North, it's just like, "Oh, those people down there are." I'm like, "Yeah, okay, sure, whatever, man. Because you guys are just perfect up here."
Yeah.
But when I told a friend of mine in North Carolina, he's like, "How do you feel about restaurants?" I mean, "Man, if you want to open them, open them. I'm not going in."
Right. Yeah.
But I would not vote to keep you from going in if this is really that important to you.
Right.
You want to roll these dice? Roll the dice. Chances are good that nothing will happen to you. The chances are really, really good. But, you know, having a family and having kids and hearing the stories about what happened to kids that get it, it's not really worth the risk to me.
Right.
But I think one of the major reasons is that it's not a political decision for me.
Right.
Like, I, you know, it's like, it's, you know, one of the most bizarre conversations I've ever had. I bought my son a Honda Civic. This is many years ago. My son's 35. So 15, 20 years ago, I got him a Honda Civic hybrid. And this woman tells me, no, you shouldn't have done that. You should have gotten a Prius. I said, "A Prius? Why would I get him a Prius? He's just learning how to drive." And she goes, "It's very important that people know that you're ecologically conscious."
Oh,
I
mean, right.
No, it's really not important that people know anything.
Yeah.
And this is what the difference is.
It's a car. It's a car. Yeah.
It's not a declarative statement of anything. It's a car. It's inexpensive, and it saves him on gas. It's great.
Yeah.
But for a lot of people, all these things are political statements. And, you know, right. I'm not, again, if that's what you need, great. But it's, none of this is a political statement for me.
So let's come back to music before we say goodbye. In the last 2 years.
Yes.
Yeah, 2 or 3 years. What's been the best musical experience of your life? And how much of that was due to chemistry with the people you were on stage with, as opposed to just technical excellence?
First of all, I have no, I was never really the best technical player anyway, so I don't really have any technical excellence experiences, although I'm much better at it now than I used to be. I'm all about music.
Yeah.
That's it. I don't have any. So the best, I mean, every musical experience I've had to me has been great.
So what about chemistry, though?
That was really great, man. We had such a great time.
Yeah.
We had such a great time. I mean, that's what you remember. You don't sit there and say, you know, "You remember playing with orchestra?" "Yeah, you know, one of the pieces, like the 132nd bar, I missed a note. It was dreadful." Oh, that crap.
Well,
How great everybody was.
you know, one of the funny things that I remember about that is the very, because we were doing the John Williams Escapade.
Right.
We get to the end of the piece and there's that long note, and I just stayed on it. And I
You did.
stayed on it. And it
Such
was,
a prick for doing that.
I know, you're welcome. But first of
Fair
all,
enough.
I was being a jerk, but at the same time,
That was great.
I did not
Funny.
want it to end. I did
No,
not want it to end,
it
man.
was funny. Well, now you have to provide context for people that don't know. It
Right.
hits a high note. It goes ba ba da ba da ba da ba da ba da ba dee. And the whole point is that I can't go anywhere until Tim brings the orchestra in. And I'm holding this note, and it's like, 10 seconds, 15 seconds, and he's looking at me like, jerk. But my lung capacity was okay. I'm like, I'm good for about 30 seconds. And after that, I would have just stopped. Are you nuts? I really would have. I would have stopped. Like, come on, man. But it was fun. I remember looking at you like, really? That was great. I remember it. I remember it was so classic.
That's I love it. Listen, Iowa loves you. So stay on here and we're gonna talk a little bit after we go off air. But
Yes,
first,
sir.
I gotta talk to our viewing audience. Thank you for viewing this. This was awesome. Thank you, Branford. Listen,
Thanks for watching, guys. Thank
if
you.
you love Happy Hour and you want to make it happier, I'm asking you to do your part and support Orchestra Iowa, and I want you to donate whenever you can, whatever you can, because the next 6 months for Orchestra Iowa and our musicians is going to be really critical. I'm normally not as forward as about this, but I want you to keep us in your thoughts, your prayers, and yes, your pocketbook. So you can Venmo.
Venmo.
Venmo. God, I am so old. You can Venmo us at Orchestra Iowa, or you can do it the old-fashioned way. Go on orchestraiowa.org and donate that way, or even just write us a check. Not PayPal, not quite yet.
Cash App.
Yeah, we're working on that, baby. Yeah, we're working on that.
Just grab a teenager off the street. They'll show you what's
Well,
happening.
we've got Darren, and ladies,
I got two of
he's
them in my
taken.
house. They yeah. You don't have Cash App? Come on.
I know. Let me try that again because I was such a geezer when I couldn't land the word Venmo. So try and Venmo us at Orchestra Iowa, or you can go online at orchestraiowa.org and help us through the next 6 months. We need you, and I thank you for your support, and thank you for tuning in. So we're going to leave you right now with a little bit of you and what is it, Kurt Elling? Yeah,
Oh, cool.
awesome. Thanks much.
Yeah.
There's a boat that's leaving soon for New York. Come with me, that's where you belong, sister. You and me can live the high life in New York. Come with me, there you can't go wrong, sister.